event. It's entitled The End of Austerity? Question mark. We should put, definitely put the question mark in if it's deliberate. Liverpool after 2020. This is the third of a series of events that we are doing in different parts of the country, different cities across the country, exploring these sorts of issues and questions in relation to not ignoring what essentially now has been a decade of austerity and how those places have had to respond to the challenges associated with austerity, but also try to take this as a moment to look forward and say, if austerity is coming to an end, if austerity is coming to an end and the spending review that we've been promised later this year happens, in a sense, what is it that places like Liverpool or Doncaster, where we've been, or Derby, or our cities more generally, you know, what do they want and need in order to be successful in the decade ahead? So that's really the context and the rationale for doing it. So that's what we're doing. And obviously, you will know we have two great speakers to share some thoughts, and then we'll have a conversation. You can ask questions or raise issues yourself. Mayor Joe Anderson, obviously many of you know, Mayor of Liverpool, and Dame Louise Ellman, who's the MP for Liverpool Riverside. And gives support. Frank McKenna was down to come, unfortunately, something happened with his family, he can't make it, so he sends his apologies. But we'll have some thoughts from Joe and Louise, and then we'll open it up and get into it, a bit of a conversation. I'm not going to say anything more other than one thing, and I think this is important, and it's partly related to the work that is in the document that is in front of you. You'll see it for yourselves. It builds on, it's based on the research that we did, looking at what happened to our cities over the last decade, essentially from 2009 through to the present day. So essentially a decade of a period where local government significantly, and our urban local government as part of that, received quite dramatic large-scale cuts. See the numbers in the document, but just to give you a sense, you know, the kind of cuts that have gone on in Liverpool equates to about over £800 per Liverpool resident. That's the biggest per head reduction of any place in the country, certainly any urban area. So, you know, we might not want to talk long about that, but I raise that point because that is a significant issue that we can't brush aside, since it provides the backdrop and the context for questions about what's happened during that period, but actually where that leaves us when we think about the period ahead. So, you know, that's a significant reduction. As I said, we shouldn't ignore, we shouldn't maybe focus on it to the extent of relatively expensive thinking about how we go on the future. So that's really the context. So Joe's going to give us some thoughts, and then Louise, and then, as I said, we'll open up for some reflections. So, Joe.
Can I use that?
You can if you want.
Yes. Who was the local government secretary.
understand the challenges that we as a city face. I think it's just important to grasp a couple of fundamentally important financial facts about where we are and what's happened to us. And a couple of them are this. I mean, when Agatha opened in 2010, we used to spend £222 million on adult social care. That's the figure we used to spend then. Today it's £172 million, and I've got to get it down to £162 million. We only receive £174 million in council tax. That's all we receive in council tax. So adult social care, children's social care, equate to around about £250 million. A year that we have to find also a billion pound, and we get 174 in council tax. Business rates is about 200 million, so it shows you the scale of the problem that we face. Now, we talk about this figure, the £800 odd a year reduction in spend to families, but the reality is that for me, it's now about 64% of local government funding that we've had taken away from us, which means that that's 440 million every year, that is lost to the economy, lost to this authority, lost to this council. 442 million, to be precise, is what's lost to us. And that's the difference between the amount of money that we used to get in 2010 to what we get now. And it's important as everybody reflects. I think, criticisms of organisations that look at austerity and look at the impact on cities, they all have to understand that each and every city, each and every second-tier city, smaller city, towns, they're all different. We're all different. For instance, to give another fact, is that in Bristol, we have around about 80,000 people in Liverpool more than they have in Bristol. There's 80,000 more people live in Liverpool than there is in Bristol. Yet Bristol get £38 million more a year in council tax because of the higher bands of property tax that they have. 72% of the properties are tenants out in the lowest bands. So it's always a double whammy for me, and I've seen that not only do we receive the highest levels of cuts, but we almost need the highest levels of support for families and for people that are living in our city. So it's a double-edged sword. It's what I call or see that is the reality of life that we face. And I can give you lots and lots more information and figures about the number of people dependent on adult social care, which is increasing, the number of children in care that we are supporting, which is increasing. And one of the things when you look at the Tory philosophy of an ideology of people needing to defend themselves and look after themselves and grow, whether it's a family, grow finances, or as a business, grow its own income, or as a city trying to sustain itself. The reality is that for cities like Liverpool, that has come an enormously long way over whatever 20 years, but certainly since 2010 when I became leader, we've grown our economies, 31,000 jobs being created, 4,000 new businesses, 11,000 new houses. All of those things are brilliant for the economy, and we generate now probably around about £23 million more in business rates and revenue coming into the city than we did in 2010. But every single penny of that money has to go to support services. It's not there for me to be able to use it to grow the economy and create more growth. It's there to support services. £59 million a year we spend on white goods to people in poverty, cougars, fridges, washing machines, and creepy streets and beds to people who are homeless who move into accommodation. A full warehouse stacked with goods is what we pay for, full and totally by the Liverpool City Council. So, you know, when we talk about what do we do as a city, it is about growing our economy, but protecting the poorest and the weakest as well. And that's what we've done, is a twin-track approach. It's something that we're proud of as a city that is built on fairness, and we try to apply that. But, you know, we've kept all our children's centres open, our libraries, our leisure centres, all of them. There's 4,000 children's centres across the city, and 4,000 libraries closed across the country, and we've kept those open because we know how valuable they are to support people and help people, especially the children's centres. So we are investing as well in services, and we are trying to do things differently to combat austerity. It means that we shape things and do things differently. But the fact of the matter is that, you know, that will then replace the direct support that we should be getting from the Exchequer to help us pay for some of those things. You know, and the point is that I see no end to austerity, and when we talk about the autumn statement, now looks like it's kicked into the long grass. It's going to be spring next year. So whether we get support or extra funding for adult social care or children's social care or any of the things that we're looking forward to that we might have got in the autumn statement, that now looks as if that's been kicked into the long grass, and there's going to be splinter time before we even get to know what is in the plans on whether it is who's Chancellor of the Exchequer come next spring. So, you know, austerity, no, it is here. I know, because I go out and talk to people, you know, this summer we're making sure that every child, 125,000 meals we provided to school children last year. We've got to do more than that this year. We've got to make sure that kids who are getting free school meals across our city don't go hungry. We know there's going to be 17,000 people, surely, who are on universal credit. There's one in three families that are living in poverty, one in three children living in poverty in this city. Behind closed doors, we know that people are really struggling to make ends meet. And, you know, I'm 61 years of age, and I'm only of that, but I'm 61 years of age. When I was a child, you know, my parents, I relied on social services, I relied on free school meals, we relied on social services for so many things, like clothes for Christmas, school uniforms, all those things. That is a fact of life still today in the sixth richest economy in the world. So austerity is nowhere. It is, you know, created by an elite who don't understand what it's like to live in poverty. That's why these same people created the universal credit system. You can't have universal credit. The system is designed to support people and help people. You can't apply a broad brush. If you live next door to somebody, you're both on universal credit, you can't give them the same amount of money. If one has special needs, one has disabled children, someone has that, one has more life requirements, you can't apply a broad stroke to everybody. And for me, you know, these, whether it's cuts or austerity to local government, whether it's benefit cuts, whether it's universal credit, they're all designed by white suburban landlords who never lived in poverty, don't understand the realities of poverty, or indeed how to get people off welfare into working. And they are so far removed from reality. So when we talk about, you know, innovation, in Liverpool, for instance, we pay £250 million a year in housing benefits. Yes, it's not the council that pays it, it comes from central government, but we haven't got council houses. We've just now done the right to build council houses again in Liverpool, and we'll start building them within the next couple of weeks. In fact, we've got the first three or four ready within a fortnight's time. But the fact of the matter is that money in housing benefits is paid into the private sector, sometimes to extremely families sharing houses, substandard accommodation, and we've got to turn that around. And it's about public sector reform. We can do things differently, we can do things better. So austerity is far as I'm concerned, nowhere near, and it's going to take us a long time to get back to where we should be as a result of the cuts over the last 10 years. I was unfortunate that, you know, I was elected in 2010 after fighting for 9 years to get a Labour controlled council. And I sat within the office that I moved into, and within days I was getting coming to just have £127 million of our job. If you lost £350 million in building schools for the future, job, we've had this thing, job, we've had, and I've lived with that. And I went to bed on the 2nd of May in 2010, hoping that we would hope that would be to match my aspirations about eradicating poverty, creating more way, and spend it to actually change. And I ended up with the Tory government. And I owe you a name then, and as an early son of seven, and look at me now. But seriously, you know, we deal with austerity, and I hate it when, you know, the people on the extreme left tell me that I'm not fighting austerity. Every single day I come into work, my life is about trying to find ways to lessen the impact of austerity on this city and on the people that live here. And that's what we have to do. It's again obscenistic that I have to borrow £300 million to fix our roads. And the only reason why we're able to borrow is because I've generated that income, that revenue, to pay the loan back that we're using to borrow. And that's so, you know, austerity for Liverpool is going to be a long time before we turn it around. We used to have £174 million in reserves. When I became leader in 2010, we had £174 million in reserves. Today, £17 million in reserves. And they are earmarked reserves that we can't touch. Because we have a legal requirement to have 5% of the overall spenders in reserves. That's just some facts and things. There are other things. You know, I remember a young lad saying to me at Liverpool food bank 2 years ago, sitting there, about 21, 22 years of age, and I was talking to him and I was saying about, you know, how he managed and how he coped with, and he was telling me that, you know, he's got no gas and he would like a microwave. And I said, okay, we'll see what we can do. And he didn't have a gas kit, he used his keys for the gas. And I said, well, how are you cooking? And he was putting beans in a plastic bag. And putting beans into a plastic bag and heating the beans up in a kettle. That's what he was doing. And I have no problem telling that. We also came last year, and that's why we do what we do in terms of when the kids who are on free school release. We had a little boy taking his sister who was starting to school to go to summer holidays. And the school gates closed. He had nowhere else to go. And he went to the school. It was a school holiday, so there was nobody there. But he took his sister because he was starving. Last year. So the point is, you know, when Esther McVeigh tells us that, you know, the growth of food banks is a good thing, you know, I feel like, I call it a gesture, but the reality is that the disconnect between the politicians who make the decisions in Whitehall and the landlords that make the decisions in real life, what people are going through every single day.
Very good. Thank you very much, Joel. Let's hear from Louise, and then maybe you can get you to think of what to say a little bit in response to what you hinted at there, about what you would ideally want to understand in your concerns about spending the news and your current position in relation to the government. Louise.
Well, Joe has graphically spelled out what austerity has meant some things for Liverpool, how it's been addressed. I must say that I think that it's remarkable how Jones' team have managed to protect me as much as they have from the ravages of past years and ongoing, because Gilbert's that's been taken in until Austerity overall. It's not so good, so it's still going on. It's not possible to protect everyone, view of what's going on, but a lot of good things have been done, a lot of people have been protected. Now, I just want to say a few words about where I think we go now and we're doing it. Reflecting it on how it is that the Jones team have been able to protect people the way they have. I think it's about taking some responsibility ourselves, knowing government is doing the wrong thing, arguing our corner, yes, very, very hard, but then thinking what we ourselves can do about it, with people, communities, local authorities, working with the voluntary sector, private sector, and other organisations. Working across all boundaries, looking at how we can bring resources together to try to address the problem. And devolution, the fact that there is a network has been itself enabled new things to be done, new ways of thinking, trying to be pioneered, for someone to be able to decide, oh, that's the way we should do things, that's the way we should get houses built, to be able to do something different without having to. Or was it half months and months and months and everything like that? So that's the thought. I think that is the idea of our next. Now, where are we now? What's going to happen? And the what are you spending with you, Julie, the water? Now, it's spending is a government statement on spending the government part for the next 5 years. It's relatively new. It was introduced in a full and groundless country yesterday, some years ago now. And it's every 5 years. So it's about what can we spend for 5 years. As Joe said, that probably isn't going to come out as all at all. Indeed, the first point in that is that there's great uncertainty in terms of government and what government does, maybe who government is, and what's going to happen. And this first is really being that they're going to get through this without making the vote of Brexit. Because we have to take this into account. Already, the Brexit issue does cost the economy a great deal of money, which affects public spending. And every way you look at it, and what might happen next, unless we know the whole thing, which we might not, and we might best make it happen, but maybe that will happen. Whatever happens in it, there is certainly a cost to the economy over foreseeable years. And that means less money now to public services. So we've got to register that. And I would say an instability at the top, a new Prime Minister, still a government without an overall majority, whoever it is, will the government still be there, will they change? Question marks. Might have had a surprise for this general election in the next few months, but still there's an instability and uncertainty. So we just don't know. So if that happens, that means question marks about funding available. But what can we do? But first, we should argue, whatever the national situation is, we should argue for fairness in funding, for public funding to relate to needs in America. And there are proposals being discussed nationally, I don't think the final answer yet, particularly in relation to local government funding, about reducing the amount of government grants that goes to local areas. So if you're in a very well-off place where you have lots of prosperous businesses and lots of very big houses around, that's not a great concern to you. Can see how you can get money otherwise. If you're in a place like Liverpool, with lots of local property, people will be able to raise the money, then most of the money does come from government grant. That means we distribute to the richer areas. That means a big deal. So I say, first thing is you've got to find a way to stop that happening, to get a fair deal with the money you have. But it's not only about public services. Public services are essential, but you can't divorce that from having a successful economy. And that means having jobs. Jobs that survive, jobs that pay reasonably, jobs that make a place that people want to come to for employment. Now, Joe and I, and the all of us, three of us here, and I was here all over the Defensive Parliament yesterday, with Lord and Pleasant, and where we were reflecting over what's happened to Liverpool over the past, not decade, 20 years, in Waterloo, and how 20 years ago, we were probably long now, Liverpool's in a very bad place. Bad place in terms of public services, jobs, people who were able to get what was mainly left the city, and they wanted to invest in. That's been turned around now, and we're now on the road, we're now successful. But we need to get even more successful, and we can't stand still for what we will need to do. But to do that, we've got to have an economy that works here. So I say, you don't have to have central government, indeed we haven't been allowed, we've not been able to, but maybe we shouldn't have to do it anyway. We should carry on working out our own, I would say, economic strategies. What are our strengths? What is it we want to build on? Lots of things, you know, like a strong university sector, very strong research sector here, very, very important. A strong science sector, life sciences, a medical centre, creative and digital centre. Areas like the Baltic Triangle, all the creative work that's going on there. Lots of things going on here. So, the port, developments of the port, seafaring, no, it's not just about ships, it's about people coming here, it's about businesses, it's about engineering, and it's about legal services, it's about transport, about many, many things. So we've got to keep thinking about strategies, where we want to go. We should just react to this crisis, what do we want to do? This work is going on, and I think it needs to be stepped up, and we need to do more to make that work. It's not just the public sector funded, some of it may well be, but it needs to be set. As well. We'll be doing all this, but we need to do more. So that's why I say the economy. Also people, part of us as well. We need higher skill levels here. We're all falling behind and doing it a long time in the levels of skills that we have. So we need to do more about that. Now recently, skills training has been devolved down to the Liverpool City regions. Not all people in government understand. So maybe opportunities there, thinking more creatively. It's about people's skills and life chances. You know, the people who need to keep the primary use of people who miss out at a young age and always learn more. We have to make it possible to do that. One thing awful for us to take in place has been adult education. It's often been a lifelong task. People to learn new skills and to get confidence and to show what they can do and maybe bring out the abilities. All of those things. So strategy, it's about people, it's also about place. And places, should people look at places as well, areas, how to make areas nicer to live in, better environment, jobs, housing, enjoyment, things to look at, to feel, so you've got to look at the place as well. So I would say, looking ahead to the future, those are the things we need to look at. Fair, public funding for our services, yes. Our strategies for economic development, looking ahead as well as the need for the future, people, training, educational opportunities, how things work. I think that's the way forward, and the funding for all of that doesn't come from one source. Government should be doing a great deal on that, what they've done over the last few years in absolute disgrace. But our salvation not only comes from any government, we've got to provide them that as well. Going to lose, I think, the support we've had from Europe has been so vital for us in transforming Liverpool, mainly due to the European Union funds, but working together with governments and other things as well. What to find another way of doing this if that is going to go with evolution. In fact, we've got some there and hopefully other more opportunities there. I think that gives us more skill. And finally, infrastructure, what's to get that one? Think people that are thinking about the transport things. That's mainly I think about other things as well. And they want to do something about them. We need to have to think big and on with the case you know in London. Where transport spending per head is about 2.5 times more than in the north of Glasgow and London at the moment. You'll get all kinds of arguments against going ahead with what's called high speed 2. Don't be fooled by any of that. What that's actually about is diverting yet more money to London for a second phase of Crossrail. Now, in London, it can argue the case for more and more investment in transport forever because there are so many people there. the listening things. And it all keeps going into London in particular, where there are so many people. And we know that there's much in places like Liverpool, where people are coming, want to come, businesses will come, we can afford the land. So that's the other way too. So that's my thinking of thought, which way we should go.
Brilliant. Lots of potential questions and issues, but reflections or more questions from the floor? Would you like to hear a little bit more about what Joe was saying or what Louise was saying, or something that's reflected on you? Yeah, just say who you are. I'll take the two together. Just say who you are, and then make your head hold. The Ascent of Cities in publication often commented on North England as a whole, Liverpool as well, as more of a skills gap than a transport gap. And this government in particular have focused quite a lot on transport. But with the skills gap in mind, I think it's been suggested that rather than focusing on connection between the city and the north, there needs to be better connections within the city regions. I'm curious how that's curious about your reflections on that suggested priority that should be better spending on within the cities themselves to improve the skills gap.
Okay, well, we can definitely get just take
that question there as well.
Yeah, can we just sort out expenditure? Because there are two types of expenditure. There's revenue, which basically supports day-to-day services and spending on stuff and so on, and there's capital. So I think most of Joe's comments to do with revenue. How have we fared in terms of capital investment in an era of austerity?
Okay, Joe, so you know it, the issues around people and skills, but it's also about how we made not only the city, but you know, the city region work effectively through transport, bus, rail, etc. Just say something on that and then we'll come to the...
Yeah, and I think, you know, one of the questions that I'm often asked is about contest two, requirements for that industry in the future. And so think about the curriculum in schools. We've got to look at, you know, at skills and apprenticeships. We've got to look at, you know, where, for instance, we've got a real shortage of nurse qualifications. And then we stop our kids into MEQ1s in school. We can't go MEQ2s till after 16. We've got to relatively think differently about that and allow kids to do MEQ1s and 2s, you know, at year 9, say at year 10. And that's still protected vocational, the academic side, but also allow kids to develop vocational skills. Similarly with, you know, the construction, we want to build 10,000 houses over the next 9 to 10 years. I couldn't do it before, because we haven't got bricklayers, we haven't got plasters, we haven't got joiners, we haven't got electricians. The new technology, 5G, the green agenda, we've got to adapt the skills requirements to get our schools and change radically the curriculum, the national curriculum, and adapt it to a more local curriculum, so that we do things differently as well. So, you know, it is also about the whole issue and agenda of public sector reform. Stop being led, and there's nobody thinking differently. It's basically sticking with the same old, and it's about time we change that. And I just want to make one very, very brief comment, going back to the point before, what Louise mentioned in the question about, well, what do we want? That fair funding formula review for local authorities and for cities was 48 years old. And Joel Barnes, who was then, who wrote it on the back of a cigarette paper, was to last for 1 year, still used it 38 years on. It's got to change, and it's got, you know, the Labour government were at fault as well, under Blair and Brown, for throwing grants at cities. And then this government took all the grants away. We fundamentally didn't change what it was required, so we allowed cities to be dependent on grants, someone took them away. But I would echo the transport, the capital, the revenue, and the skills as comments.
Well, Louise, on, I mean, others, maybe Alan have kind of thought on this, certainly from our perspective at the centre city, it is incredibly difficult to figure out capital expenditure in our cities because of the nature of, not so much what bits of the public sector may or may not spend, but when you try to disaggregate that to get it down to city scale, it's incredibly difficult. That in itself tells us something, which is that presents a problem. We think about our urban areas, which they are, as the economy hubs, the drivers of the modern economy, and yet we are not facilitated with and provided with the basic material, i.e. data, to understand what's going on in these places so we can make better informed decisions. There's a bigger debate going on there, which is not for today, but it is incredibly more difficult than it ought to be to figure out how much capital gets spent across the entirety of the public sector base in our places, which is terrible, because we know part of the mix is the ability to bring different bits of capital together, to Joe's point, with bits of expenditure. That's where we get the mix and the magic that goes on in our city.
But it's not that complex. The capital investment in the city, maybe in the main, 90% of the coastal central government.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's like the roads. And I mentioned before that £1 million to fix the roads in this city. And yes, Liverpool, the people of Liverpool contribute billions of pounds in fuel duty, you know, car tax, road tax, all of that money goes into central government, and I'm having to borrow to fix the road. So most of the money for capital work in schools, repair, school building, house building, subsidies for council houses and to build council houses for people to live in, comes from central government. So it's not really that hard to work out, because it's well over about 90% of capital funding that you see in the union comes from central government.
Yeah. Louise, reflection, because my understanding on the fair funding, there is, I've heard this in several instances, several different places, there are proposals on the table to essentially give less significance to deprivation and need as it's currently understood, which by its very definition will be an inherently anti-urban proposal. Think about that now, in a sense, in the way that government allocates money, deprivation is weighted to a certain degree over other things. There are proposals on the table to give that much less significance when you allocate government monies out, which will mean that places like Liverpool, under a fair funding arrangement, will get less per head, and other places who have lower levels of need will get more.
Yeah,
now that's, you know, that is something we should definitely align with, you know, as a city's agenda.
I think it's really important that it's taken up. I mean, what has been said is very true. And sometimes you can't all behind the name behind the title to a campaign or a project. So what's a fair moment, and you think you might know, like, yeah, that's great. And then you look inside, it can be quite difficult. It's actually very complex. And you find out what it really means is taking away or drastically reducing the elements of the things related to deprivation. And the campaigns for so-called fair funding come from other areas, which I wouldn't say don't have needs, but certainly don't have the same sorts of needs as Liverpool. And they will say, in terms of local government funding generally, and also in schools funding, education funding, you know, why is it that in their place they don't usually name Liverpool, they're in form, usually name other places, maybe Liverpool to why should a child there have X pounds more than a child in my area? And on the face of it, that sounds quite right, isn't it? Then everyone gets success and it sounds all right. But when the needs are very different, okay, and it's all right if you're going to level everything up, that's all right. It never is that. It's about taking the money down. And they found there was an attempt to do that in relation to schools funding in the last year, maybe it was the year before. And in the end, the government council just stepped down on that. Once people realised what was going on, the outcome became very loud. But these campaigns are still going on. I was asked last week to sign something going around, you know, maybe there's things called early day motions, EDMs, often asked to sign. And people often get the wrong idea about them. And sometimes I don't sign things, and people write to me very upset, you know, that this round, I haven't signed it, it's been terrible. And I always speak, you know, Penny is okay, but I mean, and sometimes
much more cozy relationship between certainly Manchester as a city
under then government with George Osborne as Chancellor. There seemed to be a window of opportunity there, even in the context of austerity and cuts, etc., for thinking more creatively about what devolution might mean. I don't know if you noticed this week, but I'm not blowing the trumpet for your rivals, Andrew, but there's a very interesting report that came out from the UK 2017 Commission. And you've got a couple of headline grabbing bits of information out there. One is that if you project forward, assuming no great policy shifts and no great change, London and the South East is going to have to absorb 50% of all new homes and all new employment in the UK over that period, something that's clearly completely unsustainable. At the same time, they pointed to the experience of Germany in absorbing the Eastern Lender after the war came down and there was reunification in Germany. And they've got a figure on it. It's, you know, the investment was, I can't remember what the figure was, 14 trillion euros or something like that, that order, in order to reintegrate a sort of a forgotten bit of the country left behind by economic change. And get it up to some sort of standard over a very long period. Now, my understanding of the German constitution, which is not very fulsome, I have to say, is that if you're thinking about devolution, first of all, it's not a unitary system, it's a federal system. So there is much more power at the subnational level. But I think what happened in Germany was partly to do with national government seeing a national initiative and a national need to do something. But a lot of the money that went into the Eastern Lender was recycled through a system which actually we designed for the German constitution at the end of the Second World War. And we haven't learned the lessons from doing that. So Germany talked about Barnet and people Barnet being outdated. I wonder whether Barnet isn't in some bizarre way the way forward. So if you're talking about a fair funding form, which gets you beyond this constant flip-flopping between Tory governments or Tory-led governments and Labour governments. So one will cut from the cities, one will try and find a way to put your money back into the cities, but there's never any consistency of purpose and rationality. Isn't it time we thought about a very different constitutional settlement, which frankly takes some of this stuff out of the hands of national government and makes subnational authorities, you know, empowered and responsible? How we get there, it seems to me, is the debate that we need to have.
Okay.
Some of the things we've done in Greater Manchester inch the way there, but we are scrapping the little crumbs off the table in national departments.
Yeah.
And we should be raising our sights.
So if you agree with that, John, how do we get there?
You've got a couple of good agenda fair from the public service. You mustn't forget that. Scotland and what's going to happen in Scotland, whether that will get stronger or whether it will separate the same, I don't know. And that's another problem, Wales as well. And never underestimate the power of London and the South. There are people who think I'm correct and say it's really London that caused the South to cause problems as well. And it's a real problem. There's a strong hold there, and all to do with where decisions are made, where people live, where they are, and an ever-growing population, which is London's strength, but also the weakness, as I would say. And the more the population, the more the call for resources, the call for more to be done in areas like the law, then they get to be reckoned. And okay, the work that's been done for the community pollution, in fact, Jordan, and our family is doing now, and arguing the case for the there is making a difference, but it doesn't really stop out that call from London. I see with interest how all this regional organisation, but nothing not quite, has grown around transport for the north, and that's been based on transport needs across the north. Now, it isn't an authority for doing anything else, it has some powers, but not that many. It's limited itself to transport, and so there is an issue, I think, of perhaps accountability on how it's actually operating. But in a way, it's through looking at that particular disruption across the north that authorities have come together and the local enterprise partnerships as well. Now, I'm not saying that is the way it has to be done, but it's interesting that it all has formed on its own accord because the need is there, but it needs something more powerful. Why does it not continue to move out? I noticed you on some devolution, it doesn't affect us in Liverpool. Some of the government's devolution is not organised, it's not systematic. Some of this to do with very localised areas, arguing internally about 2 or 3 district councils, should they have the ability for a third or beyond it, and I don't think that will be taken very far in terms of economic development. How are our concerns that we've
got in the city? Yeah, no, very good. We're getting towards 6:30 and we will finish just around that sort of time. Are there any questions or issues that you'd like to raise? Yeah. Just say who you are and then fire away.
Hi, my name is Mariam. I live in Riverside. I studied in the Northwest. I studied up in the North. But, you know, I studied architecture actually. Still studying, not process. Did my project in Liverpool, studied the history of it, fell in love with the city, honestly. Been here and back, grew up in different places. A lot of people ask me, places in Dubai. Why am I still in Liverpool? And now, you know, with the echoes of the football, I think no one can say anything, really. but my main kind of question, really, I'm saying I'm just kind of building on top of what you're saying, was, and there's one thing we learn from history is that we don't learn from history. That's, like, evident, really, there. I can only talk from my view as kind of also a young person, really, 22. Not as wise as...
Go for your questions and then you'll get your answers.
The main question is, you know, Liverpool at one point, second biggest city in the UK, had its own system, an international city, own identity. You can still see that, it's evident. You know, is that something that Liverpool, even Manchester, I guess, and Northwest in general, that's something that Liverpool maybe should just kind of take forward, kind of reconnecting that past. It's not like it doesn't exist, it's not an old idea, so this is something that's already been established. Just reconnecting it with the present of, you know, Liverpool still an international city, and we'll continue to do that, you know, regardless of whatever political situation is being echoed. And how would it be able to do that? Is it through universities? You know, is it through people? Is it through different projects? You know, I'm just curious because, you know, you hear all these things, but you kind of want to know what's happening.
Okay, Joe.
So let me ask you the thing about the band of Louise James or people have a different perception of the city compared to what they did in the 80s. And of course, how are you, yes, we have. I think the only people that have negative thoughts about it are the people who live in the south. And our brand, which is very, very much alive, if you go to any place in Wales, the brand of Liverpool is famous. And it's not just about football, it's about our heritage, our culture. Yes, where we used to be is the second city of the empire. No, we don't want to be remembered for the slave trade and so on. But we recognise that the city was built on that. And actually, we talk about it, and we educate, and we let people know that it's a dark place that we talk about. But the brand of Liverpool, where we made in the 50s and 60s, has completely changed. We've got many, many unique selling points. You know, European capital culture, historic buildings, popular music, European capital culture, as I said. We've got a lot to celebrate. We'll keep showcasing the city. We'll keep promoting the city. We'll still be positive. We'll always have any mind. It's a great thing to aim in mind and fail. Aim low and achieve it. It's not what we're about. We'll always aim in mind. Our best days lie ahead of us, and we'll continue to promote that.
And finish us on an optimistic note. Don't bring us back down now into despair and difficulty. George Pinney's left us on a high into the sunny's new challenge.
We've got to make sure that Liverpool continues to be successful. The wealth of the city is also shared by the people who live here and with the different places in the city as well. And that means we have to do more of what we need to talk about. We have to work together with every organisation we're in or not.
Thank you very much for coming. Thank you very much to Louise and to Joe.